The Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty and is armed with strength. Your throne was established long ago. You are from all eternity. The seas have lifted up, O Lord. The seas have lifted up their voice. The seas have lifted up their pounding waves. Mightier than the thunder of the great waters, mightier than the breakers of the sea, the Lord on high is mighty.
Welcome to Majesty. My name is Ron McKinney, and I'm pastor of Kinsey Drive Baptist Church. I'm so pleased that you're watching today. I'm pleased that God has providentially made it possible for you to be able to hear. And I thank God that He made it possible for me to prepare to bring something to you from His Word. You know, everything that happens to us has purpose and meaning. I know that there are fatalists. There are fatalists that say, you know, whatsoever will be, kind of live in that kind of world of fatalism. I'm not a fatalist. I'm not a fatalist because I believe that the God that I serve, the God that I know from Scripture, is a God that rules and reigns, and He is working out His will and purpose in everything that happens. He's the conductor, the orchestrator of everything that takes place, that nothing is out of His control. Man nor nature is able to do anything outside of His will and His purpose. If you don't understand that, you don't understand the Bible, because the Bible is very clear about that. We see it in the Old Testament. There are many examples that are given to us of how God is in control of the nature, as we call it. And even though men sometimes think of Mother Nature, the truth of the matter is that God is ruling and reigning in all that takes place, both good and bad. And I accept the fact that there are things that happen that we don't see as being any good, and yet God in His Word has taught us that it's in His purpose and His plan. And I accept what God says, and that He does rule and reign in all these things. So He is the one who is working all of these things out. I've told you this before, and you may get tired of this, but I hear it so often that people believe in chance and believe in luck, and they believe in something called karma, which is nothing more than a false god. I believe in God. I believe in God Almighty. I believe in the God of the Bible, the God who spoke everything into existence and then rules and reigns. And at this very moment, everything that is happening is according to His will and His purpose. But neither do I believe that man is a robot or a puppet. I believe that also God has said that we are humanly responsible. There's such a thing as human responsibility, because He commands us to do things. Yet, many times what we find is that it's God who's working in all of those things, and how it works out is for His glory and His honor. I want to take a passage that probably is very familiar to you, even those of you that don't claim to be Christians, because it's used sometimes as a way of saying, this is what I believe. And they talk about the Sermon on the Mount. Everyone's heard something about it. We've heard about the Beatitudes, and we say, you know, it says here in chapter 5 of Matthew, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the poor in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. He says, rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. All these are the Beatitudes. And we look at them, we say, now what is God doing? He's telling us really what it is to be in Christ, what it is to be a child of God, what it is to be a part of the kingdom of God. I'll tell you, it's not something where we are put upon a pedestal and we are praised and we're kind of worship for what we do and all our good works and that sort of thing. No, in all of these, we see something of persecution. We see something, there's slander against those that are in Christ. He says of us, there's mourning. All of these things tell us that that is the character of one who is truly a child of God. It is a blessed thing. It is our joy. It is our happiness to be persecuted for Christ's sake. Now that's not true of everyone, but that's true of those that are in Christ. We know what it is to be persecuted. But I want to look further in the Sermon on the Mount, and I want to highlight this because I want us to think on it, because it says in verse 17, it brings up the subject of the law. He says, "Think not that I'm come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill." I might say in this, when we think of Jesus Christ, his coming into the world, what he did was, he fulfilled every letter of the law. He fulfilled it completely. And when we talk about the Decalogue, when we talk about the law of God, whatever it might be, Jesus came and he fulfilled it, meaning he kept it perfectly. He loved the Lord thy God with all his heart, mind, soul, and strength. He loved his Father. There was a love that he had with the Father that it ebbed and flowed. He had that love with him before he came as the Son of Man. He was God Almighty. He and the Father are one. But he says here, I didn't come to destroy the law, but to fulfill it. And verily I say unto you, until heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. And then he says, whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, and the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. Oh, my friend, he's talking about here. He says, we want to remember the law of God. Now, I'm going to teach you today something about the law of Christ. Now, when we talk about the Sermon on the Mount, when Jesus stood there, what I believe we have here, we have Jesus as the new law giver. He is giving the law, which he says shall rule and reign within his new kingdom. And it has to do with the new covenant. Here it says, he says, if your righteousness, if you're seeking to keep the law in order to be righteous, he says, your righteousness must exceed that of the scribes and Pharisees. Well, you say, well, what does he mean by that? Well, they were very self-righteous people. Oh, they were meticulous. In fact, we know when the publican was praying, you remember the Pharisee comes in, and he's very devout and holy. And he comes and he says, I thank you, Father God, that I am not as other men are. And he began to talk about himself. For I tithe of all that I have. I believe him. I believe he did. He says, and I give of my alms. And he says, and I fast. And I pray. And he was giving all of the things that he did and telling how righteous he was. Now, the interesting thing is, he was praying to himself. He wasn't praying to God. He was trying to tell God how good he was and all the things that he had done. And the publican, who was a man who was a cheat and a liar, that's what he was. Publican was not a good person. He was a man that was a betrayer. He betrayed his own people, and he would skim money off of the taxes that were taken. He did all of this for himself. He was a thief. But the Bible says when he prayed and he smote his breast and he called out and said, God, have mercy upon me, a sinner. And he gets up. And he walks away to go to his house. The Bible says that he went justified before God. Now, he wasn't justified because he did any good works, for sure. Oh, my friend, his works were filthy rags. He didn't even bring them up. He just said, God, have mercy. He knew what he was. He knew he was a wretched man. But he knew something of the grace of God. God showed mercy to him. Now, what I'm showing you here is that men can be very, very righteous and self-righteous. But that's not what Jesus was looking for. He says, if you've broken one of the law, listen to that verse 19, who said, whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. Oh, my friend, that's what he says. Your righteousness must exceed that of the scribes and Pharisees. And then he gives the old law. Please bear with me a minute, because I think this is very important. I believe when one comes to Christ, he's sanctified by looking to Jesus, who is the new lawgiver. My righteousness comes from Jesus Christ alone. I have no righteousness of my own. Bear with me here. Some teach that what you do when you come to Christ, now you keep the Ten Commandments, or the law of Moses. I don't think that's what the Bible teaches, because I want you to listen to this. Look with me what it says here, verse 21. You've heard that it was said of them, by them of old time, thou shalt not kill. Well, we know that commandment. That's a commandment that's in the Bible. And it says, and whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But verse 22 says, but, now remember, this is Jesus speaking. He's speaking to this multitude of people here. He says, but I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council, but whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hell fire. Okay, I want you to hear it. This is a higher law than the law that says, thou shalt not kill. Jesus says, the old law, which was of that old covenant, was this. Thou shalt not kill. Jesus takes it above that law. Notice here, this is a higher and a greater law than the law of Moses. Will you not see this? Because what he says, you said it said of old, thou shalt not kill. But I say unto you, if you are angry with your brother, you've committed murder. Wow, that ought to shake you in your boots. I can hear some of you self-righteous Pharisees saying, oh, I have never been angry. I've never murdered anybody. I'm not guilty of it. Oh, my friend, every one of us have committed the sin of murder because we've been angry. He even brings it down to the word reka, or fool. To use those terminology, having an anger towards someone, an anger. Oh, my friend, can we not be honest before God? I have committed that sin. I have committed that. God, have mercy upon me. Forgive me for my sin of anger. But it's my sin of murder. And then he goes on. He says, therefore, he says, if thy gift to the altar, and there rememberest that thy brother hath aught against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar and go thy way. First be reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift. Agree with thine adversary quickly, whilst thou art in the way with him, lest at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge, and the judge deliver thee to the officer, and thou be cast into prison. Verily I say unto thee, thou shalt in no means come out thence till thou hast paid the uttermost farthing. And then in verse 27 he says, ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. Now, let me turn to you. I'm going to ask you this question. I've had occasion to be with men as well as women in counseling without any revelation of who it might be. But I've had them come to me and say to me, well, I've done nothing wrong. In other words, I haven't slept with them. I remember asking the question, and I said, but did you in your mind, in your heart, have lust for them? Most of the time, they're honest and said, yes, yes, I did. And my return to them is to say, you know, you have committed adultery, whether you have physically done it or not, because the Bible says that if you've done it in your heart, if you've lusted in your heart, you've committed adultery already. Listen to what Jesus says. Thou shalt not commit adultery. You've heard it said of old time. But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. My. That puts us all in the same category, does it not? Be honest. Be honest before God. Answer this in light of the fact as though you were standing in the very presence of Almighty God. And you say, yes, I'm guilty. Oh, he says, and if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. I mean, Jesus makes it so clear here. He's talking about something radical. He says, if that eye offends you with lust, better that you pluck it out of your eye, socket. Pluck the eye out. Now, he's talking about the severity of this and the fact that we must consider dealing with our sin in such a severe way. He says, for it is profitable for you that you, one of your members should perish, and not that the whole body should be cast into hell. And if thy right hand offend thee, cut it off and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. Isn't that interesting? He's saying, better to lose your hand if it's offending you, causing you to sin. Your eye, you pluck it out. He hath been said, whosoever shall put away his wife, let him give her a writing of divorcement. But I say unto you that whosoever shall put away his wife, saving for the cause of fornication, caused her to commit adultery. And whosoever shall marry her that is divorced committeth adultery. My, Jesus put some real, stringent demands on men. And again, you've heard that it's been said by them of old time, thou shalt not forswear thyself, but shalt perform unto the Lord thine oaths. But I say unto you, swear not at all, neither by heaven, for it is God's throne, nor by the earth, for it is his footstool, neither by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Neither shalt thou swear by the head, because thou canst not make one hair white or black. But let your communication be yea and yea, nay and nay. For whatsoever is more than these cometh of evil. Oh my, when we think about what Jesus says about the law, he's talking about it's something beyond what men consider. Now, when you look at the Decalogue, it's good. But the Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 9, we read in various chapters in the book of Hebrews that it was inadequate, it was not sufficient, and it is obsolete, meaning by that, not that it is not good, but that Jesus has given us a greater law. Because we are now in law to Christ. Oh, my friend, what we are to do is we are to be obedient to Christ. We're in law to Him. Now, the beauty of it, the beauty of this being in Christ Jesus is in the new covenant, we have the Spirit of God has been given to us. I hope you understand this. It's taught to us in Galatians chapter 4. And Galatians 3 and 4 would be a good passage to read. But in chapter 4, when it talks about Paul says, and we've been given the spirit of adoption whereby we cry, Abba, Father. That's an intimacy that we have and a closeness that we have. The Spirit of God has been granted to us. The Holy Spirit has been given to us. Now that's something different. That spirit of adoption is different from what the old covenant believer had. He did not have that. Now, he had the Spirit of God that he was in Christ Jesus because he was a believer. He believed in what would come to pass. He knew something of the Messiah and what he would be like and what he would do. But, oh, my friend, we who are in the new covenant know something of what it is to be in Christ Jesus and the Spirit of God to indwell us. I hope you know something of that. And we read in John 14, 15, and 16, we read of the advent of the Holy Spirit coming. And the Spirit came to enable us, the paraclete, the helper who comes alongside of us, enables us, it quickens us, it prods us and encourages us in the faith. And as we walk in Jesus and we call upon Him, He grants to us His Spirit to be able to do so. Oh my friend, that is so vital and important when we talk about living for Jesus, is that we must have the Spirit of God. And when we have the Spirit of God, then we understand. And God is the one that's teaching us and His law. And we follow after Him. We follow after Christ. You remember, He says there in John 13, He says, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you. Oh, my friend, why do we love one another? That is, those that are our brethren. I was last night with my brother Rick Patton, and I love him in the Lord, and I saw him as he's serving God and feeding the hungry and has such a hunger and thirst to be a godly man. And he takes care of these children from Mercy's Door. He has a heart for them. And what I see in that, I see in the work of God in his life. He does it because he wants God to be pleased and for them to come to know the Savior. They see what he's like, that is the Savior. Oh, my friend, it's such a wonderful thing to be in the new covenant. It's a beautiful thing because God then, we're motivated by the Spirit of God. It's a quickening. That day when the Lord was there for the Last Supper that we talk about, found in Corinthians chapter 11, and he takes the cup and he says, this is the cup, this is the blood of the new covenant which is given unto you. Do this in remembrance of me. Now when he says the new covenant, it was instituting something very new. Very new. Not just kind of a newer covenant. It is a new covenant spoken of in Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 31. It speaks of he will be our God, and we will be the sheep of his pasture. He talks about our relationship to him. We will know him. And all that are in Christ Jesus will know him. But when we take that cup, it's a symbol. It's a memorial speaking of Christ's work on the cross to bring us into relationship with the person of Jesus Christ. I ask you today, do you know this Savior? Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ? Is he your all in all? Let's pray together. Father, thank you today for this message that we read from the Sermon on the Mount. I pray that you'd use it in the lives of my hearers, that you would give them understanding, the Spirit of God would come and quicken them and give them life. For we ask it in the name of Jesus, our Lord. Amen. I thank you for being with us today, and I ask that you give us a call. I have a place that you can call. The number is 706-277-3505. If you would like to ask some questions or if you have interest in knowing more, please write me or call me. The address is Kinsey Drive Baptist Church, 2626 Kinsey Drive. That's Dalton, Georgia, 30720. I love to hear from you. I meet some of you during the week. I thank you for speaking to me. Please come up and say hello. And I love to know that there are people that are watching. Till next week at the same time, may God richly bless you.
He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty and is armed with strength. Your throne was established long ago. You are from all eternity. The seas have lifted up, O Lord. The seas have lifted up their voice. The seas have lifted up their pounding waves.